thought he was in that thing.
Well, he was early somewhere. He was in late.
Yeah, he was a little early.
Glad to see everyone this morning. Glad you could be with us to worship at Keppel First Baptist Church this morning. If you would, let's take our bulletin, some different things that we need to look at this morning. You'll turn over on the back. Of course, let's see, we had no birthdays or anniversaries this week. There's a reminder about our blessing box, of course, is treat. We do need items for it. I need some stuff back here in the folding area. So if you have anything, please add to that, and we'll get that out this week. With heavy heart this week that we go into our announcements and prayer requests. Of course, Ms. Kitty Burnley passing this week. We don't have any word on arrangements yet. And so much of the family, I think, has the COVID that we don't probably know yet when that's going to be. So, you know, it's pretty difficult. Lost her and James here in both such a short period of time. So we were just talking this morning. You know, we've had couple after couple after couple that, you know, 10 years ago lined that side of the church that are not with us this morning. So, ask that your prayers and thoughts be with that family. Tommy and Betty, if y'all want to move over here. I seen Betty got kind of concerned with that. You're going to get up and move. It'll be okay. Now as we enter into our prayer request, of course, we want to remember Joe, Bob, what is the word on that Joe this morning?
What?
The word on Aunt Joe.
We had her funeral.
Was Friday. Funeral was Friday. Okay, of course, that is Miss Claire May's sister. So please ask that you remember the family and the loss of Joe. How old was Joe?
92.
93. Boy, she could cook, I'm here to tell you. We go cut the back of her and Claire May fix lunch. Oh, golly, he was good till 1 o'clock, man. It was over. Fantastic times, great memories. Of course, I still remember the Nickel family and the loss of the loved one. Bobby Earl Lanier had two additions this morning. Becky Nickel has asked me to add one of her dear friends, longtime friend, Betty Stair. Betty is in the hospital with COVID and pneumonia at this time. That seems to be a recurring thing with this. A lot of people are getting pneumonia with it as well. And also, Shelly Bass's uncle. Now, he has just passed suddenly, Keith Marshall, over in Missouri, and they're having the graveside service for him today. It's Keith Marshall. Do we have any additions to our prayer request or any updates? Any additions or updates? Of course, we'll remember those that are in our nursing homes and assisted care facilities. They're visiting with them has become very limited. A card, I'm sure they'd appreciate a card if you take a moment and just jot them a card. We've got some addresses and things back here for those. Our homebound as well. Miss Ada Lou. All right, do we have any others? All right, if not, ask Jim Renfro. Jim, would you lead us in prayer? Remember that he's on our prayer list this morning.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've come together and worship. We ask you, Lord, to pour out your blessings on the ones who have in the family who are suffering from COVID, and during this time they lost a loved one. Miss Kitty, we pray that you'd bless that family. And we ask you, Lord, to watch over us as we deal with the dangers of being out and taking care of our activities daily. And we pray that you put your protection around us and keep us safe. Watch over and guide us as we go about our service. Guide and direct each thing we do and say that it be pleasing in thy sight. We give it for our prayer in Jesus' name.
We're going to do something a little bit different today. Instead of having you stand on the first one, I'll just wait and have you stand on the third one because you just came in. Your legs, the other part of it is not too tired yet, so you'll stand up on the final hymn. Let's start off this morning with hymn number 511, The Solid Rock, first, second, and final stand. Once we become a Christian, there's something we can always think about. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. 446 will sing all three stanzas.
Of God, on the mystery, marching.
if you would, turn back over to 502. 502, and this is one I'd like to ask you to stand as we sing. First, second, and final Sunday. 502.
We've gone through some trying times. You know, when you go through the times like we're having today, the decisions we have to make in life and all, there's just one thing that I feel like that we can count on. That's our Lord and Savior. And so I came up with this song here, but it's just one that I believe in, and one that strengthens our soul and our body.
Heavy, I felt if you only believe.
Morning, church.
Morning.
There's a blizzard out there. I don't know if you noticed it when you came in. Listen, that's too much snow for me. Cold. It's warm in here.
Amen.
It's good to see you this morning. You know, some mornings we just kind of come in, it seems like there's just a heaviness, right? It's been a heavy week. It's been a heavy week. I want you to know, church, I pray for you. Think about you every day. I hope that you're doing well. Know that God is with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you, no matter what's going on in your life or in this world. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. Keep your eyes on the Father, because He is all we have. He is all that matters, and He will see us through to the end. So I just want to let you know that. I love you. You are loved by the King of Kings, the Creator of the universe, so much that He sent His Son Jesus to die for you. And you keep that in mind. Wherever you go, whatever comes on, whatever you hear, know that the Lord is for you. We are more than conquerors, and there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I just felt I wanted to encourage you this morning. I know if you're like me, it's just kind of been a drag, right? This week has been like love. But we're here today. We're in God's house. We're together. We're continuing on with a new year and a new you. And, you know, most of the time, one of the things that you think about the most is when you think about the new year, you think about lists and resolutions. So I went to 7-8 websites and just kind of glanced over some of their top resolutions that people, you know, they did surveys, and I just jotted a few down. This is Good Housekeeping's 55 plus achievable New Year's resolutions for healthier and happier living. 55 plus. There was 56. I'm not going to read all 56. I took the top 10. 1, build a better budget. 2, cook one new thing every week. 3, read more books. 4, join a club. 5, create a cleaning schedule you'll stick to. 6, drink less alcohol. 7, quit smoking. 8, eat veggies regularly. 9, share your resolutions one-on-one or tell others about your goals. And number 10 was try a new diet plan. Of those 56 plus things, there was nothing in there of spiritual nature or anything that related to that. Here's another list. This is from Statista.com. This is America's top New Year's resolutions for 2021. Exercise more, eat healthier, spend more time with family and friends, lose weight, live more economically, spend less time on social media, improve my performance on the job, reduce stress on the job. It's like, I guess if I improve my performance on the job, I'll reduce stress on the job, quit smoking, and cut down on alcohol. I looked at 7-8 of those, and nowhere the closest thing to anything spiritual on any of those lists might be yoga or some form of meditation, which isn't really anything spiritual as far as it gets into the New Age movement. See, we're looking at a new year and a new you, and we know that transformation comes from the inside. That only God can truly change somebody. So we went back to the basics. And if you have your Bibles, open to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 26. Last week we looked at salvation. This week we're going to look at sanctification. Next week we're going to look at repentance. What does it take to make a new you in this new year? Galatians chapter 5, 16 through 26, and these are probably familiar passages of Scripture. Paul writes to the church at Galatia, "But I say, walk by the Spirit,
and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have been crucified in the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. What Paul is talking about in these verses, he's talking about sanctification. He's talking about walking in the Spirit as opposed to living in the flesh. Now, we're not going to break down these verses, verse by verse this morning, but I want to look at the word and the process of sanctification. And I want to look at how that looks as we apply it to our daily lives. So if you have your outline in your bulletin, the first thing, number one, is this, is what is sanctification? What is that other than like a big Bible word? Well, the term sanctify, the Hebrew term that forms the basis for our English translation, sanctify, means to consecrate, to be holy, to be separate, or to be hallowed. Now, the term can be generally understood as set apart to or for God, which imparts a quality of being holy or being sacred. Excuse me just a minute. I'm feeding back our live stream, so. Sorry about that. Technology, right? The term can be generally understood as set apart or to or for God, which it imparts a quality of being holy or being sacred. To sanctify someone or something is to set that person or thing apart for the use intended by its designer. In the Old Testament, within the tabernacle, it's kind of, that's where we first learn about sanctifying and sanctification. The instruments used for the various parts of worship were sanctified. For example, the pans and the shovels used at the altar, they were sanctified for removing the ashes of the sacrifice and to carry them outside the camp to be disposed of in a clean place. That's all that they were used for. You like, if you were within, you were around the altar and all of a sudden you like knocked over something and you created a mess, you're like, oh, I got to clean that up. You just didn't go over to the altar and get the pans and the shovel and start cleaning up just your everyday mess. That was bad. Because they were set apart. They were sanctified. They were set apart for a specific purpose. And you didn't use it for it. That's the same thing with the table of the showbread. That was the same thing with the lampstands, the incense. Everything within that temple was sanctified or set apart for a particular purpose. In modern day, you know, if you watch baseball, or, you know, I like baseball, and it won't be long until baseball season comes up, but, you know, a first baseman's glove is different than a catcher's mitt. It's set apart for a first baseman to use. A catcher's mitt, you wouldn't take an outfielder and give him the glove to catch 100-mile-an-hour fastballs, because the catcher's mitt, it's set apart for a catcher to use. Eyeglasses are set apart to wear to see better. And so being sanctified, in the theological sense, things are sanctified when they're used for the purpose God intends. A human being is sanctified when he or she lives according to God's design and his purpose. And then you got the word sanctification. Well, Webster's Dictionary actually has a decent definition. A lot of times you look in the dictionary for definitions of Bible words and you're kind of like, Yes, not even close, but it's actually not too bad. It says, sanctification is the act of God's grace by which the affections of man are purified or alienated from sin in the world and exalted to a supreme love of God. Also, the state of being thus purified or sanctified. Now, another definition, according to Westminster Shorter Catechism, I haven't read that. I'm sure it's a really good read. If you can't sleep at night. But it says, sanctification is the work of God's free grace, whereby we are renewed in the whole man after the image of God, and are enabled more and more to die unto sin and live unto righteousness. And one of the best definitions I've found is the one that I included in your notes. It's by Anthony Hokima. He defines sanctification as this: that gracious operation of the Holy Spirit involving our responsible participation. Now pay close attention to that point. Involving our responsible participation, by which he delivers us from the pollution of sin, renews our entire nature according to the image of God, and enables us to live lives that are pleasing to him. Scripturally, the word sanctification has three meanings. First, you're separated. Second, you're dedicated. And third, you're spirit-filled. Regeneration, or being born again, is birth. And sanctification is growth. So, I know that you're like, yeah, that's good. It's important that we know what these things mean. Number two, so how does sanctification work? Well, here's a way to help understand the concept of sanctification as understood in the New Testament. There's three phases. There's the past. It's the initial sanctification. It occurs simultaneously with justification and regeneration. It occurs at the time you are born again. It sets believers apart positionally from sin's penalty. So I am, or I have been sanctified. Now, I always thought it's kind of goofy and kind of weird when pastors said repeat after me. But I like this morning, I just like to be kind of goofy and weird. So if you would, just say, I am sanctified.
I am sanctified.
You are. You are. The second phase is the present. Present. And that's progressive sanctification. It sets believers apart from sin's power and practice. I am being sanctified. So you repeat that. I am being sanctified.
I am being sanctified.
It's our daily walk. It's what we're going through right now. So the past is we've been sanctified when we were born again. We have been set apart for God's holy purpose, and we're no longer slaves to sin. And the present is progressive. It happens every day within us. And then the third part is perfect. Perfect or complete or final sanctification. That's our glorification. It sets a believer apart from sin's presence and possibility. Philippians 3:21 says, by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. I will be sanctified. Go ahead and say that. I will be sanctified. One day, church, when we check out of this earthly body and we come into the presence of our Lord, we will be completed. We will be sanctified. It's our glorification. We will be away from sin and the trappings of sin forever. Now, in sanctification, the Holy Spirit works in you both to will and to work according to God's purpose. This work enables His people to fulfill their new godly desires, not the desires of the flesh. Christians become more and more Christ-like as they walk in the Spirit. You see, our goal as believers should be to become more and more like Jesus as this sanctification process works in our daily lives. Because, see, sanctification is an ongoing process, and we are currently in that present phase of sanctification. And that ongoing process is dependent on God's continuing action in the believer through the work of the Holy Spirit. And this ongoing process is not an automatic thing for the believer. It involves our responsible participation. That means God supplies the power and we must supply the effort. We are responsible and accountable for our spiritual walk. We need to know and understand that without Christ enabling, we cannot do good works. He is the vine. We are the branches. Apart from Him, we can do nothing. And even though we're still in the flesh of the old man is dead. We are no longer a slave to sin. So the Holy Spirit is in us, giving us the power to overcome sin. But we must yield to the Holy Spirit in order for the work of sanctification to do what is meant to do. And that's to make us more and more like Jesus. So we look at this and we look at these passages and we come to number 3. Paul does a comparison. The deeds of the flesh versus the fruit of the Spirit. Now, Paul gives us a sample list of the works of the flesh in verse 19:21. He says the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies. And these things like these I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And then he gives a sample list of the fruit of the Spirit. He said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, if we had more time, we could break each one of those down into detail. But I think most of us understand what they are and what they mean well enough. If anything, you could take two columns, and on your left column, you could put flesh at the top and you could list those things in those verses. And on the right, you could put fruit of the Spirit on the right hand and list those things. And you could compare those two lists and see that they're drastically different. He talks about walking in the Spirit. Walking in the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit first means that the Holy Spirit lives in you. Second, it means to be open and sensitive to the influence of the Holy Spirit. And third, it means to pattern your life after the influence of the Holy Spirit. We can tell if someone walks in the Spirit because their life will look a lot like Jesus. Jesus told us that the mission of the Holy Spirit would be to promote and speak of Him. When someone walks in the Spirit, they listen to what the Holy Spirit says as He guides us in the path and nature of Jesus. You see, there's no way. It is an impossibility. There's no way you can fulfill the lust of the flesh if you're walking in the Spirit, because the two don't go together. The Holy Spirit doesn't move us in to gratify our fallen desires and passions, but to teach us about Jesus and to guide us in the paths of Jesus. That is the key to righteous living: walking in the Spirit, not in the flesh. Walking in the Spirit doesn't always come easy, because there's a battle going on every day inside the believer. That battle is between the flesh and the Spirit. Paul writes that these two are contrary to one another. They're opposites. They don't get along at all. It's kind of like putting a UK fan and a Tennessee fan in the same room. They just can't get together on it, right? They're probably a little more drastic. The flesh and the Spirit are probably a little bit more drastic than that.
More like Louisville.
Yeah. They don't get along, but when Paul uses the term flesh, he doesn't mean our flesh and blood bodies. He doesn't mean these physical bodies. To break it down even more, our flesh isn't even the fallen nature, because the old man that we inherited from Adam, it was crucified with Jesus and now it's dead and gone. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life that I live in the flesh, I now live by faith through the Son of God who gave Himself for me. He gave His life for me. And so that's even gone. But Paul, as he uses it here, the flesh is that inner man that exists apart from the old man or the new man. And it's trained in rebellion by the old nature. The world, it's trained in the ways of the world, and it's influenced and coerced by the devil. You know, most of you will remember Flip Wilson, right? Comedian. He had that line, "The devil made me do it." That's not true. The devil can't make us do anything. He can tempt us, he can influence us, but we ultimately yield and give into that because that's the flesh. That's what he's talking about. And even though the old man was crucified with Christ and is dead and gone, his influence lives on through the flesh, and he will battle against us until we experience a resurrected body, which is the final phase of our sanctification process. It's the glorification. James Montgomery Boyce says, when Paul speaks of the flesh in the Greek, he means all that a man is and is capable of as a sinful human being apart from the unmerited intervention of God's Spirit in his life. It came to mean man as a fallen being who desires even at best originate from sin and are stained by it. Thus, flesh came to mean all the evil that man is and is capable apart from the intervention of God's grace in his life. The spirit and the flesh, they're mutually exclusive. We have to choose. If we're not filled with the spirit, we are feeding the flesh. We must be filled with the spirit by immersing ourselves in the spiritual disciplines of prayer and Bible study and serving and in ministry. Our Christian life is about God's spirit filling our hearts. We do not do good works for our salvation. We do not do good works because we are under the law. When God's Spirit fills and controls us, our life is truly transformed, and this transformation starts from the inside and it pours out of us. Our motivation will not be to merit God's favor or to work our way to God. Our motivation will be sincere response of love to what God has done for us. We will want to love others. We will want to be patient. We will want to show kindness. We will want to do all these things because God has changed us. He has changed our outlook. He has changed our entire thought processes. Letter B, we are to be producers of fruit. A spirit-filled person will naturally do what is right. Fruit should come naturally for the believer. A person relying on the flesh and one that is in the flesh is not able to carry out the desires of the Spirit because they're in the flesh. We are either led by the Spirit or under the law, not both. And in the passage that we looked at, he makes it clear that being Spirit-led is far superior. You see, sanctification is more than behavior modification. It's been my record in the past when I have made resolutions in the past about January the 18th or 19th, they start to fizzle out. And there's a lot of people around this country are going to have $3,000 clothes racks that look a lot like an exercise bike or a treadmill. You know, because I'm going to go out and buy this equipment, and I'm going to use it every day. And about week three, yeah, I'm going to hang these pants on it. And there it is. And that's been my track record, right? And so I really just, I quit doing that. And sanctification is more than behavior modification. Listen, I can say I'm going to eat healthier all day long, but if it's fried with a side of bacon, you can forget that diet, right? Cheat day, right? You know, a lot of those diets have cheat days. That would be every day for me. I'll make it up next year. But it's so much more than saying I'm going to follow this list, and it's okay to have goals, and I'm not, I'm just, you know, sometimes we beat ourselves up, and yes, we should want to take care of ourselves and everything, but here's the thing, sanctification, it changes us from the inside out. It's not just we're going to modify our behavior. And it's great to make goals, but the true change comes when we are following the Spirit's guidance, when we're producing fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. If a believer is walking in a manner worthy of the Lord, and if he is fully pleasing to Him, then they will be bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. So someone who is walking in the Spirit, they will be producing good fruit, proving that he or she is walking in the Spirit, and that they will also be increasing in the knowledge of God. As we walk in the Spirit, we know more about Him. This means that if you're walking in the Spirit, you'll have a constant thirst and hunger for the Word of God. You'll be reading your Bible. You'll be studying the Word. You'll be listening to biblical teaching. A follower of Christ should not have to be begged to come to church. A follower of Christ should not have to be begged to read and study the Word of God. A follower of God should not have to be begged to serve within the body. A follower of God should not have to be begged and pleaded with to be involved in missions. A follower of God should not have to be begged and prodded to give their offering or pray. If they are walking in the Spirit, they're going to be doing these things. And there's a difference between that and encouraging people in their walk. I'm talking about somebody that just refuses, and you got to coddle them, and you got to go beg with them, please, please, please come to church. Listen, if you're a follower of Christ, somebody shouldn't have to beg you to come to God's house. We should love and encourage people along the way. But if we're walking in the Spirit, those things aren't necessary. And those who have the Spirit of God, they produce fruit that reveals whether they are a child of God or not. If there's no spiritual fruit, the Bible says that God is not their Father. It says those who put to death the deeds of the body or the flesh are truly walking in the Spirit, but those who do not have the Spirit of Christ assuredly do not belong to Him, Romans 8:9. Those who produce fruit have crucified the flesh and do not submit themselves to the desires of the flesh. Those who walk in the flesh live according to the flesh. They prove that they do by their own works. But those with the Spirit of God prove that they are Christ by producing a Christ-like life. If you want to know if somebody's saved, one of the evidence, the proof, is in the fruit production. Are they producing fruit? And those who walk in the flesh, they produce the fruits of the flesh. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, drama, envy, jealousy, drunkenness, orgies, all these things that Galatians mentioned. But those who walk in the Spirit will not gratify the desires of the flesh. God provides the Holy Spirit who dwells in us. But we decide. We decide. That part is on us. Whether we choose to live in the flesh or walk in the Spirit, it involves our responsible participation. We are responsible for producing fruit. That's on us, not on God. We either choose to live by the Spirit or walk in the flesh, which, by the way, once again, the flesh has died to sin. So let her see. How do you know if you're walking in the Spirit or if you're in the flesh? While we are in the world, we are going to struggle with the desires of the flesh. But as we're walking in the Spirit, we're no longer under the desires of our flesh. The Christian life, the spiritual life that we live, is about growing in our dependence upon the Holy Spirit, who is our source of power for godly living. When we're not walking in the Spirit of God, we will be gratifying the desires of the flesh. So that's the difference between walking in the Spirit and walking in the flesh. The fruits of the work we produce give evidence of whether we are walking in the Spirit or walking in the flesh. That's how we know that we are or we are not walking in the Spirit. So here's four ways to know if you're walking in the Spirit. Number one, you're pursuing Jesus. There's a lot of ways we can spend our energy, but the first and foremost needs to be abiding in Christ. I mentioned this verse just briefly, John 15:5-6 says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. So we're pursuing Jesus. Number two, you're not focused on what the flesh desires. When we're walking in the Spirit, we'll find that our interest in many of the appetites and negative behaviors that tempt us, it naturally fades away. That's why Paul tells the church at Galatia, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. If you're not focused on those things, when you're walking in the Spirit and you find that those interests and those negative behaviors, the more we walk in the Spirit, the more those desires go away. We rely upon the Spirit to empower and guide us. That leaves us little room in our lives for the things that are contrary to the Spirit. These negative tendencies aren't removed by an act of sheer will, but they are replaced by pursuing and abiding in Christ. When you see the attraction of these behaviors diminishing, that's a good sign that you're walking in the Spirit. Number three, your mind is set on what the Spirit desires. Not only does walking in the Spirit decrease the pull of our worldly desires, it also helps us understand and experience the will of God. Romans 8, 5 through 8. Those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is dead, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. And the mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. By following the Spirit, all the energy that we use to go into chasing things to pacify or to amuse us or to entertain us, it is replaced by spiritual desires. As long as we're chasing our fleshly appetites, we cannot please God. But walking in the Spirit, it gives us life and peace. As you walk in the Spirit, you will find that you have a greater sense of well-being, and you will have that peace that passes all understanding. And then the final way, number four, is you're producing good fruit. Now, there's other ways, but these are kind of top four I kind of picked out. You're producing good fruit. Jesus warns the disciples about false prophets. He tells them that they will know these wolves in sheep's clothing by the fruit they produce. We need to be aware of the fruit our lives are producing because it directly corresponds to whether we're walking in the Spirit or gratifying the flesh. The acts of the flesh are obvious, or they're evident, as we read in verse 19. If our lives are consistently displaying things like selfish ambition or jealousy and discord, we need to take a serious look at whether we're walking in the Spirit. Genuine faith in the Lord Jesus Christ results in some very significant changes in the individual. Yes, the Christian will struggle against sin, but he will no longer be characterized by it. For the true Christian is no longer obligated to the flesh, and so no longer lives according to it. The true Christian lives according to the Spirit and is putting to death the deeds of the flesh. How you and I live reflects whether our minds are on the Spirit or on the flesh. In my church journeys, growing up and just traveling and where I've been involved, I've encountered basically three kind of groups, right? This isn't like been statistically proven or anything. This is just based upon my own personal experiences. But there are three groups. One, there are people that call themselves Christians, but they are not. They are lost, and they are incapable of producing spiritual fruit. I was a lost church member for 19 years. I know that category well. I went to church. I told people I was a Christian, but I was lost, as evermore, right? Jesus even says people will come to him and say, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we do this in your name? And he's going to say, depart from me. I don't have any idea who you are. And there's another group. There are Christians that don't produce fruit because they are carnal Christians. And they're the ones like Paul addressed in 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. Technically, every time a Christian sins, they're being carnal, but there are some living in the flesh rebelling against God. But they're true Christians, and they're not going to remain carnal because the Holy Spirit will continue to convict them to turn from that. And then there are fruit-producing Christians. They are truly trying to seek God and to follow the Spirit's guidance. Now, on my table, Jeff thought I had food. I have bananas, right? I have all things kind of bananas up here. And this is Bananagrams, right? You know a banana. These are Bananagrams. It's a game. It's a little puzzle game. These look like bananas, but they're banana runts, right? They're little baby bananas. They kind of have a banana flavor to them. This is a banana slug, right? Now, you get down to these three, they look like bananas, but this banana right here, this is a squishy banana, okay? And so, but if you look at it, you know, like, hey, that's pretty. I bought this at camp as a gag, because like in the cafeteria, they have fruit, like over in the cafeteria, they have fruit and stuff. And I would go lay this up there with the bananas and stuff and the fruit. I'd go sit at a table and I'd watch people come and grab it. And we'd all laugh at them as they go, oh, it's a banana. Now, we're down to that. So we got two bananas. And this one, listen, this one's really nice. If this was laying in a fruit bowl, at first glance, you might think, hey, that's a real banana. But it's not. It's a fake banana. But one banana is real, and I know this is a real banana. You know how I know this is a real banana? Well, I've ate a lot of bananas. I know what a banana looks like. I know what a banana smells like. I know how a banana grows. At the guest house in Haiti where we stay, they have a banana tree outside, and they grow like this, stem up. There's a big, huge stem that comes down the middle. They grow out of it like this on bunches, and there's a huge, beautiful red flower at the base of it that comes out. And I not only know it's a banana because, listen, I don't know if you know this or not, this tidbit's free, but if you open a banana like this, you break it and bruise it at the top, but the proper way to open a banana is on the end right there. If you pinch the end, you'll find the seed right there, right? That's how monkeys do it. Take that seed out so you don't bruise your banana. But I know it's a banana because I'm holding it in my hand. I've ate bananas. And it tastes like a banana. Listen, church. We'll be known by the fruit we produce. A banana is a banana. And you can't change that. And the way that you produce the fruit is by walking in the Spirit. Listen, there's a lot of people out there that say, I'm a Christian, but they're just playing games. There's a lot of people out there, they're like, they say they're spiritual, but they're just little grunts. They're slugs. I don't even have to go into that. And then there's those imitation that walk right along with the banana and say, hey, look at me. The proof is in the banana. So what banana are you this morning? We're going to have a time of invitation. So come, if you'd stand with me this morning.